Today is colloquium. It's very great pleasure to have Dr. Yu Min Lin from TSMC to come to Taida to give colloquium. Dr. Lin graduated from this department in 1996. And after 2 years in military service, 1998, he went to MIT. 5 years, he got PhD, and then went to IBM. He stayed there for 8 years. And then he formed a company, and for 3 years, in 2000, about last year, he came back to Taiwan. Okay, when he was at the IBM, he actually was a leader in doing the within electronics. Remember that IBM was late in the game, but with his recent leadership, IBM within just a few short years became a leader in within electronics, within transistor. So Dr. Lin's citation, even his was very young, more than 3,000 or 4,000. It's an outstanding alumni from this department. So without much introduction, I think let's welcome Dr. Lin.
Thank you very much for this very nice introduction. I really feel flattered. And as Professor Hong mentioned that I graduated from this department, so it is always with a great pleasure and excitement to come back here and to see some old faces, good friends, and teachers, and also newcomers. So it is with the greatest pleasure to be here to share with you some of the works that we have been doing and also some of the ideas that we had on the materials in the two-dimensional regime. And in this talk, I will talk about the two-dimensional materials, mainly for electronic applications. I'll talk about some of the challenges and the future prospects. And this is the outline of my today's presentation. I'll quickly go through the introduction to give idea what 2D can do for us for future electronics. And spend a couple minutes and a couple slides on their lattice structure and bank structure, as well as their properties. And focus on three materials, graphene and transition metal like chalcogenides, as well as more recently, glass phosphor materials. And see what kind of unique properties they can bring to the game. Spend some slides on their synthesis routes, what has the possibility of scaling up for industrial applications, which is an important feature that needs to be realized. I will talk about some 2D devices, transistor, and more recently, the application in tunnel FETs, which 2D materials may have had some advantage over conventional 3D materials. So here is the 2D material that I'm going to talk about, except for this hexagonal boron nitride. And the first 2D material that really get people's attention was graphene, discovered about 10 years ago in 2004, end of 2004 and 2005. And since then, more than 140 two-dimensional materials has been identified, either experimentally or theoretically. And the number is still growing, so it is becoming the zoo of 2D. And as you can imagine, this material will cover from insulators to semiconductors and even metals. So you can, in principle, using 2D materials alone to build up any circuits you want by picking up the right materials with the right properties. So these are some of the promises that has been proposed by using 2D materials, ranging from wearable electronics, better security for better screening and scanning capabilities such as this that you can use in the airport, foldable device, electronic devices, and also high capacity batteries that could revolutionize the transport by enable long range electronic vehicles and a cleaner energy water such as water filtration and technology by using graphene, and also the high speed high performance electronic computing. So these are just a number of possibilities that could be imagined by using 2D materials. But as I mentioned, I will focus on electronics, so I'll talk about their future in transistors in particular. So we have to really look at really amazing advance for the last 50 years to have such compact device with such a rich features and computing capabilities. And as we know, that was the accumulation of the achievement for the last 50 years, and or more specifically, the accomplishment of the so-called Moore's Law, which predicts that the density of the transistor will double every 18 to 24 months. So that's about 2 years, you have twice the density. Now, given the 50 years of time, that's 2 to the 25 power. That's a huge number. So imagine that in the 1970, one of the Intel's transistor that has about 2,000 transistors in an area of 12 millimeters. Very rapidly, according to this Moore's Law, in the year of 2000, you already have around 32 million transistors in the same, around the same area. So does anyone have idea how many transistors we have right now in a computer chip? Some guess? It's actually 1.3 billion transistors in an area no more 10 times larger than the original footprint. So if transistor were people, you could fit comfortably 2,000 people in a music hall larger than this. And now you have 1.3 billion that fits in only 10 times of the area. So imagine you have an entire China population, squeeze them into 10 music halls. That's quite an unimaginable number of efforts that you have to put in to string all the peoples to fit into this size. And that's really the power of the Moore's Law. However, it comes with a lot of engineering efforts and innovations. So of course, to be able to fit in so many transistors in such a small area, that was one of the key driving force for the electronic devices that we enjoy today. But it requires the device to scale many, many times smaller than their original size. So this year happens to be the 50 years of Moore's Law when he first come up with this prediction. And people are arguing whether this trend can be continued. But the key trend is that we have to make the device smaller so that we can put in more computing power into a smaller chip, and also to make them more energy efficient. And that has come to quite a dramatic challenge since the year of 2000 or so. As you can see, the size scaling has stopped going down for a while, and people have come up with a number of very innovative ideas to how to improve the performance without scaling the device further. That was the effort in the last decade. And since this 2010-11, Intel and other companies as well has dramatically changed the layout of the transistor by moving from a planar into a fin, so you can make a denser again. That will allow for further scaling. However, there's no proven idea how we can accomplish the scaling for future nodes. So we really need innovation from now on, actually, for each generation of electronic devices below 10 nanometers, because the conventional wisdom of scaling the device by brute force stopped working anymore. And the reason is really because we can actually make the device smaller, but the device will not perform better. The reason is that we have to control the leakage. So transistor is just a switching device. You can switch, use a transistor to control the current to on and off. It is actually more important to control the off. If you can switch the current off very nicely, then you have low leakage. Then when you put a lot of device in a chip, you don't use up so much power even when the device and the circuit is idling. And imagine that each device just leak 1 nanoamps. 1 billion devices will give you 1 amps of current leakage. That's quite significant. That's why controlling leakage is even more important than controlling the on current. And thus, no leakage control, no scaling for the device in future nodes.
Excuse me, the previous page, the thinner store, so there's a mild kink. Is that understood, the dynamics?
You mean here?
Well, not just that, it's deeper for the dots, but this thinner store, this line there, you know, it's power before and after, but it's a mild kink, so what is that?
Well, I think a number of features attribute to this this line. This is, of course, just a prediction. And there are a number of innovations here, switching from bipolar to CMOS, that could contribute to the kink here. And also the innovation of the copper process. I mean, there are, in addition to the proof of scaling, there are also material changes along the line, along this journey. But actually, that was a good point that in the 90s, I think the BJTs also face a serious limitation because of the leakage. And the CMOS was able to dramatically limit this leakage that enables the scaling in the 90s, close to 2000. And now we are again facing the same issue, that how can we control the device leakage when they scale down? Imagine that the transistor, when you scale down this gate, you need to scale down not only your foot, you also scale down the pipe that carries the current. And to put it into engineering terms, we are talking about the electrostatic length called the lambda. This is related, as you can see here, by this equation. But the two features that's more important is the channel thickness as well as the oxide thickness. So of course, in order to have a good short channel effect, the short channel effect is equivalent to saying about how good your device can be turned off. Here it says that if you have a device that has a long channel, then you can relatively control the electrode potential well, while if you have a short channel, then you'll start lose control of your leakage, so-called DIBO, the drain-induced barrier lowering. So this DIBO effect limits your capability to control the leakage current. So you need a certain length, L, over 5 lambda. That's the rule of thumb. Now, for silicon, germanium, and also other 3-5 materials, consider a gate length of 5 nanometers. That requires you a thickness of the channel that's less than 1 nanometers. That's also hard to imagine and also very difficult to achieve for a channel with this small thickness while containing the surface smoothness. And that's why the mobility in almost 3-5 and bulk semiconductors, they start to degrade as the channel length, the channel thickness goes beyond 10 nanometers and below. However, this is where 2D material can come in for rescue, because 2D material inherently is already atomically thin, while at the same time, because of the surface is free of dangling bonds, they could afford a higher mobility. The mobility is the capability, is a parameter used to measure how fast the electron hole moves under the influence of the electric field. So the higher the better. And the 2D materials, in principle, can maintain a pretty good, decent mobility even at very small dimensions. So we can imagine that for future nodes to scale, we have to go to really low dimensional materials. That's inherently low dimensional, not through some kind of thinning process that allows you to have thin body as well as good mobility at the same time. So here I would like to just review some of the fundamental properties of the 2D materials. As I mentioned earlier, we're talking about graphene, which is consists of carbon in a hexagonal lattice like this, transition metal dichalcogenides. It typically consists of 3 layers of metals in a sandwich structure. The top and bottom layers are the atoms we call S, X, one of the chalcogen atoms, either sulfur, selenide, or telluride. And the middle layer is a transition metal. Now you can see that already the graphene has a 0 band gap, and this material has certain band gap depending on the layers, also the composition of the materials. And blast phosphor is similar to graphene, that It has only one element, which is phosphor, and formed also in a layer structure. We're going to go through their band structure quickly in the next few slides. So here shows the band structure of graphene, and this is the easy, I mean, understanding the band structure is the most fundamental way to understand how it behaves in a transistor. So I will spend some time here. Graphene is this honeycomb lattice with a unit cell of two atoms. We call it A atom and B atom. Even though they are labeled as A and B, but they are actually identical carbon atoms. So you have a very spatial symmetry requirement defined by this AB in this distinguishability. And each carbon atom forms a sp2 covalent bond in this lattice. And many of you are familiar with the band structure. It has a massless direct cone structure at the K point in the Brillouin zone. So it has a linear EK dispersion relationship. And because of the symmetry requirement, certain scattering are not allowed. So you could have a very good mobility in the graphene. In the 2D materials, it's a transition metal dichotogenized. So in short, we call it TMD. If you view it from the top, it will also look like graphene in a hexagonal lattice. However, the AB atoms now are no longer identical. And actually, in this lattice point, you have two atoms, as you can see here, by two yellow dots at this coordinate. And because of this, another distinct feature is that in addition to s and p orbitals, you also have d orbitals that participate into the bonding. So that gives rise to a much richer feature in their band structures, so especially when you stack them together into multi-layers. So first thing that would occur is that because of this asymmetry between the AB, you would have a band gap at the K point. This is a band structure in the single layer TMD materials. In this example, I choose MOS2 as a demonstration. Now, when you increase the number of layers, one distinct behavior is that you will change from direct band gap into indirect band gap because of this rising of the bands of the valence band at the gamma point will start to have a more and more higher and higher energy. That is because of the DZ and PZ orbitals through this coupling between layers that rise the energy here and induce a direct to indirect band gap. And this will reflect very strongly in their photoluminescence behavior. For example, this group at Columbia, they show that in a one-layer graph, one-layer TMD material, MOS2, you have a very strong photoluminescence because of the direct band-to-band transition, while this direct band-to-band transition will be prohibited when you have go to two layers. So your intensity at the same energy will be 10,000 times lower. And this sample was done on a suspended sample. So in terms of electronics, this direct band gap to indirect band gap will also have some consequence, as we will explain later for the tunneling behavior. Now, brass phosphor, we can also start building their lattice from a hexagonal lattice, but in this case, it's a buckled hexagon, or so-called puckered honeycomb lattice. So you can view this as you pick two of the lines and then pull them down. The C and D atoms are pulled down, and A and B atoms are pulled up. So you have this up and down puckered structure that breaks your trigonal lattice symmetry. And actually, so your unit cell will become a square here that contains four atoms in one unit cell. So it has also a very different Brillouin zone geometry than the previous two materials. One of the features you can see that is that because of this the asymmetry in the XY direction, your band carriers also have a very different effective mass in the two directions. In this case, the X direction that is transport in this direction has a much smaller effective mass than the transport in the Y direction. So that will also be reflected in the electronic properties. And different from TMD materials is that when you increase the number of layers from monolayer to bulk, you decrease the band gap as those in the TMD, but it's always the direct band gap. So this is one of the features that sets BP material, black phosphor, aside from the TMD materials. And this is because of the anisotropic band structures that gives rise to angle-dependent conductivity in the fast particle material. So how do we synthesize these 2D materials? And it looks interesting with a lot of physics to study. We'll start with the extensively studied material graphene and graphite. So this is a graphite in 3D form, consider the stacking of graphene into many layers. By the way, a lot of you here probably have already studied graphene and graphite, but how many of you have really seen a graphite, except for the big picture here? If not, I brought one with me. That was a souvenir from my earlier careers. This is a piece of graphite, and if you have a scotch tape, you can start making the graphene right here. I'll put it here if you are interested. You can take a look later on. And we know that the graphene can be peeled from graphite layer by layer. Nanotube is just a graphene wrap up in a tubular structure, and we also have fluorine. So, of course, one of the ways to make graphene is to take a piece of pencil and write graphene. And then you are making graphene, but you really cannot make any measurements on them, except for that you can claim you already make some. But at home, we can try this. This is a famous scotch tape method. And amazingly, this also works for other 2D materials that I just described, the TMD materials and also glass phosphor, because they are all have this kind of layer structures. But if you found this method 10 years ago, you could have one of these at your home too. Yeah, this is a Nobel Prize. But for industrial applications, we really need to find out a way that can controllably synthesize these materials in large areas. So the one of the methods that was proposed and used extensively is the CVD growth method. And now there are many variations of this CVD method now. But basic principle is that you have a metal catalyst that will dissolve some carbons into your metals, and with some anneal and cool down, you could form a layer of graphene on the surface. And this is a SEM image of this graphene on copper. You see these ridges, these lines, that is because graphene has a negative thermal expansion coefficient. So when it cools down, it actually expands, but the copper shrinks. So you form these ridges, and that was considered a way to make sure that you really grow graphene on copper in the early days. Now, for large area production, one could take a piece of copper using the CVD growth, and then find out a way to delaminate this layer of graphene away from the copper. Then you can reuse and then transfer this to any substrate, and you can reuse the copper. This was a way that was commercialized to really produce low-cost graphene. So another question. So how many of you have worked on graphene experimentally? Can I see some hands? And how many of you have seen graphene larger than, say, 1 centimeter? Must be some, right? This is NTU. Or two? Now, what I have here is a piece of wafer that has 4-inch graphene on 6-inch wafer. Actually, I think this is 8-inch. Yeah. I forget. 4-inch, yes. Has graphene on it. And you can also take a look. You can see the edges of graphene on this wafer, very uniform. That was made by a method like this. And the next question is, have you seen graphene larger than this from this audience? If not, I will share with you another thing. That's a roll of graphene on a PET plastic that has a size of meter size, also made from this method. So that shows that the graphene material is really closer than you would imagine, and actually more practical, that could have an impact on our technology already. So here I will show.
If you are talking about a 4-inch or 8-inch,
it's still polycrystalline. I mean, single layer.
But one piece.
Yes, one piece. Electrically conductive. Yeah. So here shows a video how this could be made in a pilot lab. This was the work that I was involved in the previous company. So this graphene, actually, this is how we made a really large area of graphene on the copper. And it, you already have graphene on it. This is just rolling out and start to prepare for the transfer process. We first with lamination to put some coating on the copper, and this is the electrochemical delamination that separate graphene from the underlying copper and now transfer finally to this PET substrate here. And you can use this to make batch process very large. You can see the gray area, that's graphene. Two layers that's been subsequently processed to enhance the contrast.
That was your company name, right?
Yes, Bluestone. We want to choose Blackstone because this is black. But unfortunately, there is an investment company that already take this name. So there was actually within 5 to 6 years, a lot of progress has been made in the graphene synthesis from using this scotch tape method, which was sold per micron 1 pound. So 1 centimeter will cost 1 million for this size at the time. Of course, that was joking, because no one could make 1 centimeter graphene from flakes. And up to 2003, there was already some of the technical barriers has been overcome to at least prove a principle showing that this material has a way to scale up and to grow continuously on the roll-to-roll process.
So what kind of industry or company will buy this?
Good question. I mean, in the previous career at Bluestone, one of the companies that we have a very close in contact with, Touch Panel, the flexible electronics. The reason is that you can imagine this is actually a piece of transparent substrate, but with very good electrical conductivity. So a lot of things that could be made using this as a starting material. Now, a similar approach has been studied to grow other 2D materials using CVD. MOS2, for example, can be grown by CVD by combining MOO3 and the sulfur in the same furnace, heat it up, and then with some chemical reaction, you will form MOS2 on the substrate. This was a very popular method, but you can see the grains are rather small still, and they are isolated. So still, a lot of improvement has to be made. Sulfurization was another popular method that you pre-sputter a metal on the substrate and then sulfurize to react to form layers of MX2. Or another method by thermolysis that you dip coat substrate into a solution that contains MO and sulfur, and by thermal anneal in the sulfur environment, you can convert them into MOS2, even though they are polycrystalline. However, all these methods, the challenges, and I don't have the answer, and this is a challenge for, I think, in the field, is that MX2 chemical formulas ratio requires 1 and 2, but in all of this process, it is very difficult to maintain this ratio in the final film. And without this firm ratio, you would either have a sulfur deficit or MO deficit. That could become a defect. So the defect control and also the purity control of this method becomes critical. And this is also one of the, I think one of the challenges for TMD materials, that because you contain two elements. Rather than carbon, you only have one element. Phosphorine, you have one element. It's pure elements. And here you have two. So containing this ratio is, of course, a very key challenge. Now,
it's not continuous.
Yeah, it is not continuous. Here, actually, there are domains, and they are seeded from nucleus from different sites, and then they merge eventually. So how they merge, whether it's an MO merge or sulfur merge, that will also give rise to very different qualities. So still the growth is not a finished business yet. It is still a field of in progress. And black phosphor is a more recent comer to this field, to this zoo. It has a relatively short history, so still there are no known methods to grow blast phosphor on substrate directly. So all the blast phosphor devices that has been studied so far, as far as